Good morning, everyone. I hope you enjoyed the sport yesterday, and I hope, like me, you've been enjoying watching the surfing and skateboarding, which looks magnificent. More of that in a moment. But let me also congratulate my Japanese friends and colleagues, and all the Japanese on a gold and a silver yesterday, I think, in judo. So congratulations. It's always a good start to get some medals at the beginning of the competition. Just to tell you that the president today is at weightlifting, and I won't run through all of the sports that are on today. I've got two more knowledgeable people than me, but you'll see there's a very long list of sports on today. And in terms of medal competitions, I think it's something like 10, I think, is it? 18 medals today. I'm talking sports, not disciplines. okay, so as you will have seen, I have two people, obviously I have Masa with me, my counterpart. I have two people who know a lot more about sport than I do. So let me welcome Kotani Makako, who is the Tokyo 2020 sports director, and of course Kit McConnell, who is the IOC's sports director. So we'll hear from them. First, as ever, we will be happy to take questions on any subject, but we thought probably the sports directors probably we can begin with, and then we'll see where we go from there. So Kit, I think, first, sure. And then we'll go to Mikako-san.
Thank you very much, Mark, and thanks everyone for joining us this morning. I think, as Mark said, it's perfect timing to be here with you after really a great day of Olympic sport yesterday with 11 Olympic champions at the end of the day, and really the focus on the field of play, on the athletes, where we always feel that it should be. So really great to be with you after this first day, and then even more today out there on the field of play, including, as you said, Mark, two of the signature new sports, the first time ever in the Olympic Games. Over recent hours, we've seen the first generation of Olympians in skateboarding and in surfing, and this really underlines the innovations and the developments of the Olympic program. So it's fantastic to see, and the timing couldn't be better to be with you today to talk about this. I think if we just go back one step maybe to see where we were 6 years ago when we were discussing the development of the new flexibility that came into the Olympic program, and this came through Olympic Agenda 2020, where we gave the opportunity to organizing committees to propose new sports in their edition of the Games. And from there, as I think everyone in here knows, Tokyo seized that opportunity with the proposal of the five additional sports that we have on the program here in Tokyo. These really provide a balance of the traditional, if you like, with the baseball and softball and karate, which really have a strong connection traditionally here in Japan, and equally the three youth-focused sports of skateboarding, surfing, and sport climbing, which have come into the Olympic program for these games also. These allow us to do a number of things. They continue to provide the balance across the Olympic program between team sports and individual sports, those that have traditionally been a part of the program and those that are new innovations, and it doesn't end just with those sports. We have, of course, a number of events in other sports like 3-on-3 basketball, like BMX freestyle, like the mixed gender events, and we saw one of those in archery yesterday with the medal event there. And all of this adds up to a package of building on what is an incredibly successful, in some ways traditionally successful, sport program, but continuing to innovate within that as well. So again, a great day to be here speaking with you. That package of new sports, new events around Tokyo was designed to be focused on more youth, more urban, more women. And Makako will talk about the gender equality also, which is such an important part of the Olympic program and the Olympic Games now. But that gender equality is obviously embedded in each of these five new sports. Four of them are fully gender equal in terms of athlete numbers, and the only variation in baseball softball is we have the same number of teams, but the team size is obviously slightly different between baseball and softball. Otherwise, there is full gender equality across all of those new sports and new events, which really underlines our approach to providing gender equality on the field of play as well. And maybe just a couple of final points regarding these new sports and events. I think it's really important the way that we have looked to include them in the program, but also really celebrate the culture and the community that comes with these sports. If you take skateboarding and surfing, for example, the two that have started today, it's been something very deliberate right from the start that we wanted to give these incredible young athletes the Olympic stage to perform on, but also wanted to celebrate and create a connection with the communities and the that are out there with these sports. And I think it's something that has come through very strongly, including from the athletes themselves and the commentary they've given about how important this Olympic journey, this Olympic experience, the fact they are Olympians is, but equally the way that it's continued to celebrate where they come from and the connection with young skaters and young surfers around the world. And it's really creating the connection, but celebrating also who these people are and who the communities are. And I think that's been one of the great successes. The other thing that we have seen, and it was also a really positive sign, you've seen even this morning, some of the countries that these skaters and surfers, the sport climbers, the karate athletes are coming from. And this is also why having these sports and these events in the Olympic program is so important, because around the world, it gives an increased focus in new countries. It brings in new investment, new development into these sports and the 206 NOCs around the world. It raises the profile, and this helps the development of these sports in places like Africa, Asia, different parts of the world, obviously building on the areas where they are already incredibly popular and have a high profile. And being on the Olympic stage, the broadcast, the attention that is on these athletes and these sports back into all parts of the world really will inspire further generations in these sports, not only to be Olympians, but also to engage in the local communities of these sports. So, again, great to be with you here today celebrating these innovations in the Olympic program. And obviously, this sets a base as we move forward to Paris, where we have the addition of breaking also, along with the continued inclusion of skateboarding, surfing, and sport climbing. Looking forward to seeing all of these over coming days as well. So, Mark, happy to take questions afterwards, but again, I think it's a really historical day in terms of the evolution of the Olympic program and the value and really incredible communities and traditions that these young athletes are bringing to the games, and we can see the value for them in celebrating themselves as Olympians, which has come through really strongly on the same footing as all of the other sport athletes in the national delegation. So great to be here with you today, and again, thanks for the support in these new sports and new events coming into the program.
Thank you very much, Kit. And let me turn to Katani Makako, sports director for Tokyo 2020. If you would like to give us your views and add some thing from the point of view of Tokyo 2020, please go ahead.
Thank you, Mark, and thank you, Kit-san, for speaking about the sports, or a specific part. We have been talking every day, twice in the morning and afternoon, and sharing all the, of course, the problems, but the excitement and happiness sharing together every day. So it is very special for me to be sitting here speaking to all of you with IOC Sports Director Kit McConnell. I would like to talk about gender equality and diversity and inclusion, which we as a Tokyo 2020 Organizing Committee is really putting a lot of power to improve. One of our vision of this games is this gender equality and diversity and inclusion. I was very happy and thrilled to see the beautiful opening ceremony yesterday, thinking back how hard it was for the athletes and how long it takes for them to actually be here at the Olympics in Tokyo. They had to come such a long and difficult tunnel to make it to the Olympics. So seeing all of them being so happy, so excited, was so hurtful, touched my heart. But we're sorry that we had some concerns and fears about the opening ceremony before the games, including diversity and inclusion. But I think seeing all these athletes' smiles, at least for me, covered everything. Here we are starting our sport games with all the effort of everyone involved in opening ceremony, also in the games, on the first day. Not only the athletes, but the flag bearers. I myself was a flag bearer of Japanese team in 1988 when I participated as a synchronized swimmer. That was such a memorable, special moment for me at the beginning of the games. But from Tokyo 2020, with support and the leadership of IOC, we were having men and women flag bearers together marching. It was so great to see them being like a nice pair leading their own delegations. And also the Olympic oath, where the member was very gender balanced, not only the gender, but the generation and the many different sports and traditional sports and new sports were included in athletes and coaches and judges. So I think it was a very typical moment that we were showing the diversity through our games. And during the games on the sports side, I'm sure you already know, but our game is most gender balanced games in history so far. Almost 49% of participants are female athletes. And we added 18 mixed events, which is double from Rio, or I don't like to compete from past games, but more equally participated by mixed genders. And five sports to be concluded by women's finals. Before, there are many more finals done by men's athletes, but at Tokyo 2020 Games, five sports will finish with women's finals. And women's events have more competition awards and medal events than men's on the last day to finish our games, which is incredible. Through those, I think we are showing good balance of genders, but this is just the beginning. We are hoping this game will be not only the sports side, but everyone involved in the games will realize the importance of gender balance and diversity and inclusion. And through sports, we can change our society, we can change our country to be better, that everyone respect everyone, respect their speciality, including, gender, LGBTQ and transgenders, everybody. So we would like to make this game as a epoch making for the future of Japan, and with the power of sports, I think we can do it. So I hope this will be just a great start, and we'll continue to promote gender equality and diversity and inclusion for the future in past to Paris.
Thank you very, very much, Kako. Let me just, I think Kit wants to add a few more things on gender. Kit.
Yes, thank you, Mark. And wanted to start also by adding my appreciation to Mikako and her team. Mikako, we start our days speaking at 6:45 every morning, which is a regular part of games planning. But I really just wanted to acknowledge the work that you personally and your sport team are doing, including out at every one of the venues, and being an Olympian, you're continuing to put athletes and sport at the heart of these games. So thank you very much. Just maybe two quick additional points from the IOC in regard to gender equality, building on Mikako's comments. The mixed events, and I think we've touched on this before, are really important to us because they really embody the equality of male and female athletes on the field of play. In some ways, there's nothing more equal than a male and female competing as one team on the same field of play towards the same sport performance. And again, we saw the embodiment of that with the archery mixed event yesterday, personally there to see that, and it was fantastic. So it's really a practical embodiment of that gender equality on the field of play in those mixed events, and that's why that's so important here, and we're further increasing the numbers, as Makako noted, as we go forward to Paris as well. And secondly, just I wanted to highlight why also gender equality for us is not just about numbers and percentages. We know for every opportunity we give to a female event in the Olympic program, this often leads to the same event being added to other multi-sport games, to being further promoted in World Championships, World Cup events, in the IF's own programs. So it really has a ripple effect beyond the Olympic Games as well. And equally, for every individual female quota place we bring into the Olympic Games, we often see that being reflected also in increased quotas outside the Games. But that also leads to a lot of investment, a lot of development around the world at different in different countries, through National Olympic Committees, through sport ministries, through others who invest in female athletes to go for that qualification place, to go into a qualification process, to qualify to the Games. So there really is a positive ripple effect that that amplifies the impact for every single one of those additional quota places we create for women's athletes, and that's why it's so important to reach the numbers we have here in Tokyo and reach that absolute equality in terms of numbers of athletes in Paris as well. So it really has a wider impact than just the Olympic Games, and why it's so important that we lead on that change as well. Thank you, Mark, and thank you again, Makako.
Thank you very much, Kit. Just to say, we will, at the end of the press conference, have the latest testing figures. We haven't forgotten, so we'll come to those every day. But yeah, let's start then with Liam there. And yeah, someone at the back there, I can see with your arm, if you want to come forward to the microphone. Yeah, that would be good.
Okay. Sorry, I have to lower it a little bit. Good morning, Liam Morgan from Inside the Games. Question for Kit, if I may. 3x3 basketball started yesterday, skateboarding obviously today. You talked about these being more urban, but these sports were designed to have, you know, loads of people in the park, you know, enjoying them and watching them and hopping from venue to venue. How sorry do you feel for the athletes in these sports who won't be able to compete in front of fans and in front of crowds, considering these are kind of what these sports are built for and designed to do? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Liam. Good to see you, and hopefully you're getting out and seeing some of these sports as well. Look, I think firstly, you touched on a really important point about not just having these sports in the program, but what they bring to the Olympic Games in terms of formats and styles. Obviously, there was the development of the urban parks and these urban clusters that we had developed around 3 and 3 and sport climbing on one hand, and then Ariake on the other hand as well, Liam, as you're alluding to. I think these are a really important part of the Games moving forward. We saw these come in Buenos Aires around the Youth Olympic Games, as you'll remember, with the urban park and the other parks, where we talked about bringing sport to the people, not just bringing people to the sport. And we took that concept into the planning here in Tokyo. Look, the situation with the spectators is one beyond the control of the athletes. And I think the key thing for them, Liam, is that they have the Olympic stage to now perform on. You know, it's so important to these athletes, and we saw that, you know, if you take skateboarding, you saw the message from Tony Hawk himself talking about what it meant to them to be an Olympian. And the three sports and disciplines you mentioned, 3-on-3, surfing, and sport climbing, this Olympic stage is so important. Obviously, the way in which they're presented is designed to engage as much as possible, be it the competition, be it training, be it engagement with fans. This is obviously a part of the sport, but we're also reflecting the wider situation here in Tokyo. But the key thing again, Liam, is let's focus on the performance on the field of play and what it means for these athletes to be Olympians and showcasing these incredible athletes and new sports to the world.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's go over here. And if someone, yes, Wakako, if you want to go to that mic when the time is right. Yes, please, go ahead.
Yes, thank you. This message is from Makako, and it's on gender equality. I'm just wondering, how much of a difference do you think these gender equality goals can make when you still have so many persistent attitudes in society, including here in Japan. I mean, you had an executive that had to resign over sexist remarks. So I'm just wondering, how much of a tangible difference do you think it can make?
Oh, thank you, and pass on. Thanks to Mikako. Sorry, Mikako, you want to start on this one, and
sorry,
I can build.
The question was to Mikako.
Sorry.
Well, I'll take an answer from anyone who would like to provide one. But yes, it was okay, directed to her.
Mikako, you go first, and
yeah.
Can I go?
Yep. Yeah. Sorry.
From Japanese side, please excuse me to speak in Japanese because I really want to talk clearly.
Regarding gender equality, as you pointed out, there has been inappropriate comments from the former president, and we have faced many issues, and we are aware of that. It's better if those never happened, those comments were not made. But every time those incidents happened, we learned lessons from that. We tried to figure out what lessons need to be learned, how we can change a society. We tried to be forward-looking so that we can seriously take this issue and have discussions amongst ourselves so that we can reach a solution. I think that is very important. In sports and also elsewhere, I think once things get going, you sometimes cannot improve anymore, but it's the same. If you are not improving anymore with the sports, you try to change the way you train. So regarding gender equality, there are many things that we have to do in Japan, but every time we will learn, we will discuss the matter, and we will try to resolve that. This is not just happening at Tokyo 2020. This is a major agenda that we need to address as a Japanese society. So, and this has become a major trend. Also, even after the games in the sports of Japan, we will try to improve the situation further.
Thank you very much. I should just say, well, Kit, I think, wants to say a few words. I should say we've got a briefing tomorrow where we'll actually be joined by Yanis Exarchos from OBS, and we'll be talking about gender presentation in the media by us, because we have been trying to change the rules as well. I don't think it's an instant answer to the issues, but I think it sends really strong messages and signals, Kit.
Well, thanks, Mark. And maybe just to add from a sports side also, it's we're looking beyond the field of play. And obviously, you know, we've done a lot of work on reaching gender equality on the field of play with athlete numbers, with the event program. But also from a sports perspective, there's other areas that we continue to address with international federations, National Olympic Committees and others regarding coaching, technical officials. You know, we were at Taekwondo last night, and I think they've got full equality in terms of the numbers of referees and judges, the technical officials here, which is fantastic as well. So it's a really holistic approach that has to be taken from a sport perspective as well, not just the athletes themselves, but much wider across all those areas and the portrayal, as Mark said, and will be addressed in more detail tomorrow.
Thank you very much. Okay, let's go to Akako, and I think Graham Dunbar from PA wanted to ask a question, and then the lady behind.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Wakako Yuki from the Yomiuri Shimbun. Actually, two follow-up each to Kit and Kotani-san. Kit, regarding these new sport, when, as you say, in Buenos Aires, I experienced myself that the very culture of skateboarding, for instance, was to involve and have intellect with fans, and you feel yourself amongst into the sport itself. That was one of the fresh, actually, memory. And here, unfortunately, as Liam said, there's no spectators, there's no mingling, and no kids trying to trial. In a way, how are you regret? Of course, spectator issue is not controllable, as you say, but thing is, this was, as you say, historical opportunity for the IOC and traditional sport to have a new trend in and in a show to the world, and yet you couldn't show it in a full color. How regrettable, and how you could try to amend it into the future. 小谷さんに伺います。今のお話ありがとうございました。
私ども
の, その日本人のジェンダーの意識というのはやっぱり、
gender awareness amongst the Japanese.
ここまでのご発言などにありましたように内向き内輪なら許されるというようなその認識の甘さ、
very inward looking. We have this sense that we're not very advanced in this area. We're quite behind the world. Now, when it comes to women, there aren't that many women who are leaders in either the business or political world. Now, in the Olympic Games, we had a variety of people who were the placard bearers and other people taking part. By showing that to Japan, what kind of seed do you want to plant amongst the Japanese people? What kind of change do you want to trigger?
Yeah, should we go with Kit first? Yep, Kit, do you want to answer?
Hey, Wakako, firstly, good to see you again also. I think there's two parts to your question. One is regarding the portrayal of the sport, if you like, and the second one is the athlete experience. Again, in terms of the portrayal of the sport, as we said, the portrayal is going out to the whole world. And for the first ever time from this morning, the whole world is seeing Olympic skateboarding. They're seeing skateboarders as Olympians. Skateboarding is reaching out to new audiences. And the existing Olympic audiences, some of them may be seeing skateboarding for the first time. And if you take the population here in Japan, there will be millions of people watching Olympic skateboarding here in Japan and potentially watching skateboarding for the very first time. So it is reaching out to new audiences, and that connection between the sport, the community, and the Olympic Games, I think, has come together incredibly this morning. So I think that it's really something special we're seeing there, and more than ever, the focus is on sport and on the field of play and the athletes themselves. In terms of the athlete experience, you can only imagine what it means for these surfers, these skateboarders, these karate athletes, these sport climbers, the baseball and softballers, being part of these games, being part of a National Olympic Committee delegation, being in the Olympic Village, mixing with other sports athletes from their own country, seeing these thousands of athletes and really having that unique experience as the first ever Olympians in many cases. So the athlete experience for these athletes is absolutely incredible. Of course, when we look forward, we'll continue to build on the planning around these integrated urban environments that have been developed from Buenos Aires, taken forward here in Tokyo, and you've already seen the planning for Paris, and you can imagine the opportunities that cities like Los Angeles and Brisbane can give us in the future for these environments. So that will definitely be something that is part of the planning moving forward, to have bring together these urban sports that have really low requirements in terms of adaptations of field of play, that can engage with people for competition, for training, as we were saying. This is part of the longer term planning for engagement around these sports moving forward. Thanks.
Thank you. Mikako, sir.
Hi, Yuki-san, ご質問ありがとうございます。
Thanks very much for your question.
Then, ちょっとスケートボードの
So there's one thing I want to talk about, and that's about having no spectators at the skateboarding competition. So I went to the 2018 Youth Olympic Games in Buenos Aires, and that was the first time that I saw urban sports up close. I thought they were so cool. And after they finished competing, all of the athletes were saying that next our stage is going to be the Olympic Games. We are going to follow the Olympic rules. And they were having meetings saying that we are going to promote our sport more and more so that we will be able to go to the Olympic Games. So I was so looking forward to seeing them on the Olympic stage at the Tokyo Games. Of course, it would have been much better if we had spectators. Takato-san, the judo gold medalist, yesterday said that he was just grateful that we are having the games. So for the athletes to have the opportunity to give a performance is something that I want to draw your attention to. Having no spectators and all of the other restrictions makes the Games very different from what they have been before. So athletes, members of the IF, members of the media, all have to follow the rules, and they have to be creative in how they are going to operate within the rules. So the Games are very different from other editions of the Games, but at the same time, I think it brings out the power of sport even more. Next, we are going to have the Paralympic Games. And we're not going to count what we don't have. We're going to look at what we can do with what we have. This is one of the key messages of the Tokyo Games, and I think that it is the positive aspect of the Tokyo Games. So even the fact that we have no spectators, I want to put a positive spin on that and continue to move forward. Now, regarding gender, as I said before, in terms of sport, in terms of volunteers, flag bearers, and also the tray bearers who are going to be featured in the victory ceremony. In terms of gender, in terms of whether they have physical impairments or not, we have made sure that our mix is extremely diverse. After Agenda 2020+5, the IOC is going to work on the governing bodies. So it's not just going to be the athletes. They are going to work on promoting women having executive places in the governing bodies. And my understanding is that IOC is going to lead these efforts. As you are aware, the president of the organizing committee is a woman. She is an Olympian. And I myself am the sport director, and I am a woman and an Olympian as well. So we have females in our leadership, and we must show the world. And as a sport director, this is something that I want to show the world as well. It does put a certain amount of pressure on me, I have to admit. So by showing gender equality to the whole world, I want to promote more and more women in positions of leadership. And I hope that the Tokyo Games bring about this kind of change in the Japanese society.
Super, yeah, let's go to Graham Dunbar from AP. Graham, and then we'll go to the lady, yep, there.
Thank you, Mark. A question on tennis scheduling, and clearly not ideal when the world number one and other top-ranked players are questioning how games are being scheduled and how courtside didn't seem to be prepared for the heat, not enough ice. Why is it that there couldn't have been a heat break taken and an evening session used when the court was available and no fans would have been inconvenienced? Why was that taken, and are you planning to be more flexible today or in the days ahead about how you schedule games, make full use of the time available? And a quick separate subject for Massa. Jamaican track and field team seems to have an issue about not being able to train because their training facility is not available. I'm just wondering what it is that's happened there, and if that is a problem, how it's being addressed.
Sorry, Graham, which track and field team?
Jamaica.
I think you.
Yeah. Hey, Graham, thanks for the question. Good to see you. Maybe I can address both, and Makako may want to add afterwards. In terms of the tennis, if we take a step back, Graham, obviously a lot of the competition schedule has been built where possible, depending on the sport, to accommodate avoid the hottest parts of the day. But that's not possible with every sport. And on top of that, there's really extensive heat countermeasures across all of the training and all of the competition. And that has been in place for a number of years, developed through the test events based on feedback, and then generally has been working well across the games so far. In regard to tennis, I know tennis is looking at that, the International Tennis Federation, and to answer your question directly, we'll support them in any measures that they're looking to put in place to address that the particular points that came up yesterday. So we'll support them in looking at that, Graham, from the ITF side. In regard to the Jamaican track and field, what we do is whenever points like that are raised to our attention, Makako and I and our respective teams work with the NOC relations team to firstly understand exactly what the issue is and then address it, and obviously having athletes train and compete is the focus of any of the decisions. So whenever something like that comes up, we jump on it straight away, understand it, and then look to address it and rectify it so the athletes can train and compete. I don't know the details of that case, but that's how we approach anything that comes up and is reported to us.
Thank you, Kit. Any extra thing to add, particularly on the Jamaicans, or is it something that we will come back to you on when we get some information, I would guess?
Yes. Thank you. Regarding the schedule, 競技あの事件に関しては、
with the IOC and the Tokyo 2020 and also with the IF, we have been coordinating closely. And that's how we set up the schedule. And depending on the day or depending on the time of the day, it can be hotter, cooler, or it can be rainy, but we have taken robust measures to heat. Heat countermeasure was one of the big topics at Tokyo 2020, so we have enough ice and water. And when we go to, when I go to the venues, the venue manager is always busy running around to get enough ice and water. So we are fully aware of the measures that needs to be taken against heat, not just for the athletes, but for the supporters, officials, and also to the sports officials. We offer them the cool vest. So a cool pack is inserted into the vest. It's well received by those officials. So we do have creative measures in place to countermeasure the heat. And we will try to cater to any requests that will come from the athletes to fight against the heat.
Thank you very much. Yeah, let's go over here, and then lady there's been waiting for a while, gentleman behind, but we'll soon be running out of time, but carry on.
Hi, Rachel Bachman from the Wall Street Journal. Another heat question. I wonder, since we have a number of outdoor events yet to come, athletics has yet to start, what is the threshold at which organizers would consider postponing or rescheduling an event, for instance, temperature, heat index, or some other measure?
So I think probably we'll start on Makako if you want to add, but let me start with Kit and then we'll see where we go. Yeah, Kit.
Yeah, thanks. As you can imagine, it's really sport by sport, and each sport has very sophisticated regulations around this, which they've developed over a long period of time. And it's both preemptive in terms of, you know, all of the countermeasures building on what Makako explained. But there's also regulations in place and guidelines in place sport by sport. So it's really a sport by sport decision. But also, again, that's reflected in how the competition schedule has been structured across a number of sports. And then equally, the regulations are in place. Things like heat breaks, for example, in football at certain points, as an example. Other sports, there's additional measures that are placed to allow the players to cool at certain points of the game, depending on the structure between points, between sets, on substitutes, benches, all of those types of things prior to the match and after. So it really is sport by sport, but across the games, there's also independent experts and advisors that have been helping Tokyo, helping us, and working with each of the sports to put in place all of the support they need. So it's not as simple as just saying at a certain point, all competition across all sports has to be impacted. It's really sport by sport, depending on the nature of the sport, the length of time the athletes are on the field of play, and other factors. And so it's up to each international federation. But again, as I mentioned in response to Graham, we provide full support for the federations in implementing those regulations.
Thank you.
Mikaka, do you want to add anything, or are you okay with that?
It's just as Kit explained, regarding the competition schedule, we have working together with all of the IFs. They have a lot of experience, so they were the ones who had the final say. Now, the organizing committee has developed its own heat countermeasures. It could involve ice, it could involve water. We have athlete lounges where they can take a break and cool down. And if it's really hot, we will take heat breaks. Also, we monitor the weather forecast very closely. That's about the heat as well, and but also, like, you know, typhoon. We actually have a weather information center which updates data every minute when it comes to the latest weather information. So we make sure that we can respond immediately to any changes in the weather.
Thank you very much, Akako. Let's go over to that microphone. And gentlemen, yes, if you could go across to that one, it would make it quicker. Thank you very much.
Hi, Rachel Axon from USA Today. A couple questions. First one either from Mark or Makako. I know the rowing schedule has been impacted by the possibility of the tropical storm heading this way. What, if anything else, has been or may be changed as a result of that? And then question for Kit, the change the IOC made to allow organizing committees to propose new sports to come in. I'm wondering what, if any, concern you all have about a sport like baseball, softball, which is here now, not going to be in Paris. I think we would all, you know, possibly anticipate that being in Los Angeles. Sports that may come in and out of the games and the effect that has on how that sport operates, training, the whole system coming up. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Makako. I think if you want to take the rowing question, that would be good.
Rowing.
Yes, regarding rowing, the competition that was supposed to have been taking place tomorrow were pushed forward to today and yesterday. We are now in the process of making another decision to change a schedule. Also, there will be some sports that will be impacted by the weather, but we can get information in advance, and we are closely discussing with the IF. And if they propose us that we should change the schedule in advance, then we will consider that option. We have the competition scheduling changing committee.
We discuss and we decide the right timing and the date to make a better condition for athletes. That's how it works.
Thank you. Thanks, Rachel, for the question. And exactly as Makako said, look, competition schedule changes are a normal part of any Olympic Games, particularly those that related to things like wind. You know, sometimes there's not enough wind for sailing and there's too much for rowing. And this is a normal part of every Olympic Games to deal with these types of changes. To answer specifically your question regarding the organizing committee proposals and the flexibility, I think that flexibility has been at the heart of the decision, and we knew that this was likely to lead to some sports coming in for a particular edition of the games, or maybe a couple in a row, but then depending on where the host was, maybe not being included to a subsequent games. If we don't do it that way, then it means that a sport coming in is effectively committed to being on there, and it makes that the barrier to come in even higher and potentially more difficult. And I think you've seen how important it is to the athletes being here in Tokyo. If you take baseball, softball, and karate, which are not included in Paris, I think to say that they wouldn't be included here in Tokyo, I think that definitely take the opportunity to be included in Tokyo and be Olympians and showcase their sport to the world and have all the benefits that have come from that promotion and development. So yes, it does lead to variations between games, but that's intentional in terms of fitting those sports to the particular edition of the game. So a sport like breakdancing or breaking coming in for Paris has that really particular fit with Paris's vision of reaching out to urban youth communities and really fitting with their vision of the game. So it does give greater opportunities than having a separate system where it may be more limited numbers of sports and being permanently on the program may provide. And that flexibility, I think, is a great opportunity for the sports and their athletes.
Thank you, Kit. Let's have that and the gentleman here, and then we'll take these two last questions, gentleman there and gentleman there. Yeah, so please.
Thanks, Mark. G'day, Daniel Sutton from Channel 10 in Australia. Just a question about the medal ceremonies at the pool this morning. Obviously, I asked this question in the context of understanding the euphoria and excitement that the athletes are feeling up on the podium. But this morning we have seen some of the medalists hugging up on the podium, gathering together for photographs on the top of the podium and removing their masks. Has there been a relaxation of those rules, or is it a situation where any action will be taken or reminders given?
Yeah, I can take that one. I obviously haven't seen that particular incident, but no, there is no relaxation, and we would urge and ask everyone to obey the rules, whatever stakeholder you are, us, the IOC, media, athletes, everyone. And you know, it's not a nice to have, it's a must have. It's important both for the sports, and for everyone involved, and of course for our Japanese partners and friends particularly also, and it also sends a strong message. So we would ask people to please follow the playbooks. I think yesterday Christoph Dubi put it very well. We understand, we're all here, there's a lot of excitement, and of course when you win a medal, we feel for the athletes. There are things, unfortunately, that we've had to make stricter. I'm sure everyone will be reminded of. We have a chef de missions meeting every day in the village. These messages are constantly passed, and as I say, not just to athletes, but to all of us. It's really in our own interest and the interest of everyone and the interest of safe and secure games that we do obey these rules. Thank you. Yes, there were two more questions, I think. Yeah. And there was a gentleman down here, I think. But yeah, yes, please, sir.
Thank you. Hiroshi Hiyama from Agence France Press. Thank you very much. Okay, just a quick follow-up to this tennis question. I wanted to make sure that are you saying that the heat countermeasures are sufficient and that they're enough, or are you saying that it's ITF can make a decision to make, they have option to have the schedule adjustment to be made for the athletes? And then my question is that so far the coronavirus outbreaks or coronavirus situation within this Olympic Sofia appears to be like relatively controlled. I mean, obviously there are some measures not being observed here and there, but it's, I think as far as like a number of positive cases, this seems to be relatively low. What do you think of that? Are you feeling that it's things are going as designed? Are you happy with how things are turning out? Of course, it's only been a couple of days ever since the Olympics has started. And then also the point number two related to that, if you could respond to this, there's a thinking out there in the city outside of this Olympic biosphere that the Olympic cannot be helping to the number of cases that are being seen outside of Olympics, but inside of Tokyo, the city. Are you going to say anything to the people of Tokyo to in attempt to persuade them or convince them that Olympic is not necessarily putting extra burden on their medical system, et cetera? Thank you very much.
On tennis, I would ask probably Makako, and then Kit, if you want to add, and then I can take the one on the COVID questions.
テニスの方で暑さに対する懸念が上がっていることは理解しております。 I know that there are concerns about heat. 今の時点でそれに対して何かスケジュール変更するというところには至っていませんけれども、
We have not decided to change the schedule, but the athletes and officials' safety are the priority.
Also, so, そのコンティンジェンシーという意味では、風とか雨とかだけではなくて、異常な暑さということも検討材料に入るということになりますので、改めてこれ
を検討する必要があるかどうかということで、to determine if the contingency plan has to be applied. So we will be in close discussion.
Yeah, on the
Yeah, sorry, just to also just reiterate the earlier comments and building on what Makako said, I think as I mentioned earlier, it's really important that the International Tennis Federation are the ones leading on those discussions. They're the ones that have the direct contact with the players themselves. They're the ones that know, obviously, the regulations of the sport and what's normal practice to adapt as necessary. And as Makako said, Tokyo will support them, and we as the IOC will support them in addressing that. But it's appropriate that they lead that discussion with the players and looking at that particular point. Thank you.
Yeah, on the COVID issue, I mean, obviously we've covered this many times. I mean, our job is we are doing our absolute best to convince and explain to the local populations all the measures that have been taken. You all know, excuse me, you've taken two tests before you got here. You took a test when you arrived. There's regular testing. Many of us are tested every single day. The athletes and the village is the most tested community probably in the world, possibly ever. So we hope that that message is getting across. And what I would also say, it's not just the testing, but it's also very, very high levels of vaccination. The IOC is 100%. The athletes, I think, are between 70 and 80%, 80-something percent, 86, I think it is. And there's also isolation. There's also distancing. The two populations are, sadly, to all intents and purposes, more or less kept apart. The athletes and the stakeholders of the games are more or less, as far as we can, kept at distance from the Japanese general population. And that is a shame, of course, because it would be lovely to have more of a cultural exchange and so on. But, you know, we understand that, and we hope that all those measures that are being taken will really, really convince people here of the efficacy of what's being done. And as I said yesterday, don't just take my word for it. The World Health Organization Director General praised us for the messages we were measures we were taking, and also said, by the way, that the most important thing, getting round to level of cases, which you described as very low, I think, or relatively low. He said it's not actually just about that, it's more, in fact, about the measures being taken, and they have advised us every step of the way on that. Unfortunately, there was an egregious breach of protocol at the beginning. I forgot to ask Massa to give you the figures, but here we can give you actually the straight figures and you can decide for yourself. I think it's 0.06%. Is the rate off the top of my head, but I pass over to you, Massa.
Yeah, of course. First of all, apologies. If you were not able to receive the table at the very beginning of the press conference, there has been a logistics challenge. But what I can tell you is that as of 23rd, this figure is coming from the starting from the 1st of July until the 23rd, I can tell you there was a 35,000 tests were conducted at the arrival, and there was a 24 positive cases, which mean the positivity rate is 0.07%. And in the meantime, I can also provide you the number of screening tests which have been conducted since July 1st till 23rd. The number is nearly 170,000, and among those, 37 cases were found to be positive, and the positivity rate is 0.02%. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Massa. I think probably, given the time, last question, so please go ahead, sir. Thank you.
So let me ask my question in Japanese. I'm from Kyodo Tsushin. My name is Hasegawa. First, this has to do with an earlier question. So the games have started in earnest, but some athletes and coaches in the spectator seating areas are taking off their masks and they are shouting. You said that you were sending a message out to the NOCs to follow the playbook. However, shouldn't you be stricter on the ground? Shouldn't you tell them to stop in the venue? What are your thoughts on this? The second question is about transport. We have heard that there is a big delay in buses which take the athletes to the training venues. Sometimes the athletes have to catch a taxi to get to training venues. So are you aware of this problem? I asked the IOC and the organizing committee, and if you are aware, what are you doing about it?
Thank you very much for that question. Two parts. Let me maybe kick off just with the strictness. I think I hopefully gave a pretty long and detailed answer earlier on. We do take this very seriously in terms of mask. Yes, it should be, the rules should be applied very strongly, no matter who you are, whether an athlete, member of IF, whatever, IOC members, everyone should, and we urge everyone to follow those rules, and we will enforce them as far as we can. There will always, unfortunately, be breaches, but we will keep them to an absolute tiny minimum. On transport, I can tell you that it was raised at the meeting this morning between the organizing committee and the IOC. there are always teething problems, and this is a very serious transport, is a very important one for the smooth running of the game. So maybe Tokyo 2020, if you want to. I think your question was specifically about athlete transportation, but we realize that transportation is a problem for a lot of stakeholder groups.
I will take that. そうですね。まあ、今マークが説明した通りなんですが、
Yes. So the situation is as Mark just explained. Now, regarding people who are not wearing their masks, we will make sure to send out strict messages using the appropriate channels. We will send out firm messages saying that mask wearing is essential to the success of the games. Same goes for following all of the COVID rules. Regarding transport, you mentioned a case where an athlete had to take a taxi. I'm sorry, I'm not aware of those individual cases. However, I am aware that transport is experiencing some issues, including delays. So they always have buses on standby. And if we get a lot of athletes at the departure zone, we make sure to bring in that standby bus to take the athletes wherever they need to go. So we are trying to do everything that we can so that we can operate the transport services smoothly, and my understanding is that the situation is improving.
Thank you very much. We will be back tomorrow, as I say, with Yanis Exarchos from OBS. And just to finish with, I've just been told that Japan has won another gold medal. Ahashi Yui in the individual medley 400 meters. So congratulations. Another gold medal for Japan. Thank you very much. Maybe we can have one during every press conference. That would help. Thank you very much. See you all tomorrow. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.